Welcome to everyone today. My name is Boyan, and today we are going to talk about why there is a problem between software architecture and all this agile mindset and methodologies that we are talking about. First of all, I want to start with some excuse, because if we take a look at the dictionary, the word agile is actually an adjective. And if you take a look again at the topic that I have chosen, then there is something missing. Software architecture also needs agile. Then we need some noun if we have to be, I guess, to be a complete sentence, right? So to fix this, I chose a couple of options that today we are going to be talking about. And these are actually that software architecture also needs agile thinking. We also need to incorporate it into the entire process. We have to think of it as a part of the process, not of something that it's done once and then forgotten. Software architecture also needs agile practices. All these tools, processes that we can use, we have to apply them also to the software architecture, not only to the development, not only to the testing, but to also to the software architecture. And if we combine these two, then we have that software architecture also needs agile execution. We have to execute these two so that we include the software architecture in the whole process. If I go back to my early days as a developer, one of the typical architectures that I was doing was this, basically this three-layer architecture. Everyone is familiar with it. And if you even take a look at most of the websites today, I'm sure that at least 90% of them are using this architecture. So what is this architecture? Well, we have basically some web interface, or this our user presentation layer. We have some business logic or domain logic or rules engine. There are a lot of words that one can use to describe this. And then we have some data access layer, which does the only thing to communicate with some kind of database, be it SQL or MongoDB or something else. And there is nothing wrong with this architecture. It is popular because it's very simple and people understand why we separate these layers in that way. However, what we do is that we do this, we write these diagrams, and then we start coding, and then we forget about this architecture. Even if our project requires changes, we do it, but we do these changes only in the code. And our diagrams stay like this, and they're not actually representing what we are programming anymore. Maybe at some point you say, okay, maybe I should put something else, maybe I should put some vertical layers as well to make it more nice. So then you add caching, authentication, and then think, okay, now my architecture is done, so I can continue working. But if you think today that more and more logic is being put, for example, into the browser applications are getting richer and richer. We have also mobile application. This is part of our systems. This is also part of the architecture and should be described in one in another way. We need also some boxes here. What is happening? This is the overall system, and we have to think how it relates to our project. Then maybe we need some other layer, some API layer to communicate with our mobile application or our browser application. Maybe we need some layer to talk about some external web services, because nowadays everything is going about services, be it microservices or something else. We're talking to some other system, external system. So our architecture is much more than just these three layers that were on our web application. It's the whole system that matters for us. Before we continue, let's define software architecture. I'm sure that every one of you has definition in his head, and if you open Google, and you can find more than 100 definitions of what software architecture is. And the problem is that this term is a bit vague, and people make this own interpretation. I really like this definition of IIE standard, because it gives us four main elements of describing an architecture that we could use later. We have a system. We have a system, and this system has some components. These components are not just staying there, they're not static. There is some relationships between these components. And these components, they relate to each other, but they relate also to the outside world, which is the surrounding environment. So basically this system, the components, their relationships, and the surrounding environment, this is making our architecture, how we communicate, how we describe these items. When we start talking about Agile, we've been doing this all day, and when I'm discussing one or another topic with my colleagues or some friends, and the first things that they say is, yes, we are also doing Scrum. There is nothing wrong with that. I mean, Scrum is very popular, but the thing is that Agile is not Scrum. Agile is different than Scrum. Scrum is only a small subset of what Agile gives us. And Agile gives us much more. We have extreme programming, Kanban, Lean. We have a lot of practices, a lot of tools, processes, how to execute. And Scrum is just one implementation of this. So when we're talking about Agile, we have to think of all these tools and which one is the best in our case and how to use it. Furthermore, if you think that how maybe you apply Scrum in your companies, I'm sure that there will be some of you that are not doing as Scrum writes in the books because you think that this way it fits better your company. Maybe you don't do the stand-up meetings I've been talking about, don't do them every day, maybe do them once a week, maybe once a month. Maybe you do the iterations every 2 days instead of every 2 weeks. You adjust the things that really matches your needs and your requirements on your team. But then what is about Agile that is so problematic with software architecture? Well, if you take a look at the Agile manifesto and Agile principles, we have that Agile is all about getting changes. There are changes and we should welcome them whenever they come. Even late in the project, we should respond in one in another way with some solution. We should be able to deliver software, working software frequently so that our customers, they get an idea of what we are doing as a company for them. They should see that we are producing something, even one button that we have changed the color of, well, this is a change, and the customer should see this right away and give us feedback immediately. We should become more effective as a team because Agile is all about being a strong team and producing something together. When this is happening, then we can be effective, we can be flexible, and we can be productive. So Agile is all about how we are reacting to change. If we take a look at some statistics here that I have found on the internet about some of the Agile practices and how often we apply them, we can see that, for example, refactoring. How many of you are doing refactoring in your everyday work? Yes, a lot of people. And this is, I mean, we know that refactoring has to be done once in a while because while we are producing, we are leaving some technical debt that has to be removed at some point, otherwise it will be problematic at a later stage. But as we go down here, you can see that, for example, clean architecture, which is just a set of practices how to produce architecture and how to integrate it, how to make it agile, it is not as popular. It is very, very rarely used and applied. So there is something missing in the teams, something missing that is preventing us from applying a good software architecture. Because there is a belief that if your team is agile, then everything is agile. But that's not the case. In practice, if your team is agile, your architecture is not necessarily agile. But if you have a good architecture, this enables agility. This enables your team to be more effective and more productive and more flexible afterwards. So software architecture is part of the agile process. It is also an iterative process, and it has to be kept running all the time together with the other parts of the development, the testing, the design, all these phases. Now, when should we start doing software architecture? When should we start thinking about it? In the middle of the project, maybe not a good idea. Maybe should be somewhere in the beginning, but when exactly? When you start meeting with your clients to discuss the software architecture or the whole project, then there should be at least one representative for every area. I don't say it team because everyone is one big team. So you need a developer, you need an which can be also architect, you need a tester maybe, you need a designer, you need the client himself. Maybe if this the client is representing another group of users, maybe one of these you should also be with you there, because these are the meetings when you get to know the system, and you should be together and see the system from different perspective, from different points of view. And when you are there at these meetings, you have to use the client as much as possible. Clients, they don't know what you can do for them. They don't know maybe what IT as a field can do for them. They don't see issues in that process that they're maybe manually writing one document every day, or maybe 10 times a day. They think this is totally fine. They just need a bit nicer colors on this document, maybe. But you as a developer or tester or designer, project manager, you have an idea what you can do for them, because you see the things from outer perspective. And you should use them to tell you, because they, your clients, this thing that what they best can do is to tell you what they do every day. They're really good at this, and you should use this, and you should provoke them to give you more and more information about their everyday work. And these meetings is actually the first time where you should think about how to do architecture. And this starts already the specification of the system. Big companies, they tend to produce really a lot of documents. One maybe 100 page document where they describe every functionality of the system. This system should be scalable. This system, when you click on this button, you should get this dialog showing a list of all the employees, etc. They describe every single piece of functionality that the system is about. But what's the problem with this? How many people of you like writing documentation and keeping it up to date? Right. Well, exactly, this is the problem. I mean, this is an extremely boring process. No one wants to do this. But yes, also. Yes, and when you have this big documentation, it's really, it is important that it is there, of course, because it describes what the system is going to be. But it's a real challenge about writing it. And just imagine yourself sitting with your client. At this time, maybe you're taking some notes because the client can't wait you that you're fulfilling everything in your template. And so you're probably taking some notes. After the meeting, you're transferring these notes to your template, maybe. Then you're getting some documents. Maybe you don't fill some parts because you think they're irrelevant. And then at the end, you send this 100-page document to your client, say, hey, please, is this what we'll be talking about? And you get the answers, no, actually, I meant something totally different. And then the story starts again. What I want to point out here, you want to say something?
Yeah, why do you put
on? Yes, this is what my point is about. That when you are sitting on these meetings, and you're discussing this with the clients, I mean, this should be a creative process. You don't think of it as an interview where you're sitting with the questions and, okay, what is happening when I go from page one to page two? All right, this is what is happening. This is not an interview between you and the client. This should be a creative process. You should use any kind of media that you have. Post-it notes, write on the whiteboards, take some pictures, play some games maybe in your room. This should be really a free space where you can get as much as possible from your client. And once you can get this, this is already a specification of the system. I mean, you can write some sure, like some small boxes there, and the clients can see what is happening, they can see how you're thinking, and then can give you feedback. No, this is not what I meant. It should be like this way. And it's, you can update your information right away instead of waiting another time. So by collecting all these different medias, then you already have some documentation. This is documentation. It's not one 100 page document, but it's like many smaller artifacts that you could use. So now the question is, how is this a good thing? Well, yes and no. The good thing is that everything is happening right there, and there is a common understanding between you, or everything in the team, of course, and the client. If something is misunderstood, then it can be fixed right away. However, then you risk that you produce too many artifacts, it can become a bit chaotic. I mean, how are you going to structure this afterwards? That you have some post-it notes, you have some pictures, you have some whiteboard drawings. You need a way to keep the things, all the artifacts at one place so that you can relate to them at a later point. So this is a challenge, and this is what the team should become, should agree how to do it. Maybe they decide, okay, we take a picture of everything and we keep it online somewhere, or maybe we have a special room which is only about this project. If it's a big company, maybe you separate one room and say, okay, this room is only about this project, and we keep these pieces of information on the walls, maybe. Maybe you can draw on the walls if they permit this. So this is something that the team decides how this should be structured. But it is a challenge, and it should be addressed in one another way if you don't want to lose documentation. The next, like, going to specification, when you start already thinking about the future architecture, then comes the question about how to document the architecture itself. So you're basically moving a bit from some piece of information about the system to producing already some architecture. So why is this important for us that you need this documentation? Well, software architecture, as we saw, these four elements are all about decisions, how we want to do them. We need to take decisions how many components our system is going to have, what the relationships are, and how they relate to the external environment. So all these decisions should be written down. If we don't do this now, then we risk that later we challenge one of our decisions and we don't know why we have taken it. And then we risk that we change our decision, but it's going to be too late because we have already destroyed the previous work without knowing what we have done. Furthermore, if you know, although we are working as a team, the teams are not a constant. Some people leave, another people come. And when a new person comes in your team, then it's a new team. It's not the same team anymore. And you need to start everything almost from the beginning, because this person should be involved, should get the same knowledge as other people in the team. And this is a very time-consuming process and very hard process, actually. So to help these things, we need some kind of documentation of our system, of our architecture, what decisions we have taken and why. So how do we document things? How many of you are using QML today? Only 5-6 people. Okay, yes, and this is everywhere. People tend to ignore QML. What's the problem? I mean, it's a standard, actually. It has version 1, it has version 2. Universities teach it, at least when I was in university some years ago, I had a course in UML, and I know that also a lot of universities have courses in UML. So what is the problem? Why are not companies using it afterwards? Well, there can be different reasons for that. Maybe it's too complex, maybe too many things, and you don't know how actually to describe your architecture. When you start, should you describe activity view, process view, maybe some class view? How many details should you add? I mean, these are all the questions that you ask yourself and you don't know the answer. I mean, no one wants the answer. This is just a personal opinion or how you feel it this way. And if you're not the person that likes doing documentation, this is totally fine, then probably you end up with just 3 or 4 rectangles and some arrows connecting them and say, yes, this is my system. I can see where my services are, I can see where my database is, and I can continue working from that on. Then why not just know UML? Why don't we continue this? I mean, we are not using QML anyways. We could use everything else then. We can use our own drawings. We can use the same post-it notes as we used with the meetings with the client. I mean, this should be a free process. Put your energy there where it is most needed. It's needed in generating decisions. And these decisions should be saved in one in another way. So do this which most you like. And the team should, of course, understand it. So there should be common understanding between each other in the team how you do, how you save data, and how you save artifacts. So this is, for example, can be some examples. Maybe you do some process diagrams here if you want to describe some particular process. Maybe you want to do some activity diagram, but why should we do this? Is not according to the standard. This is very, very simplified version. But you get an idea. I mean, it's really common understanding when you see two boxes and yes and no, then you understand this is probably a branch and it means something. Why not do something like this? You just draw and then take a picture of it. It's very simple, and it can be, of course, challenging here to understand what this has been written. I don't know either what it is. It's one of my past projects, but I don't remember it. But if the team at this point agrees that, yes, we understand what it means, and we know that later when we look at this, we can continue working on our decisions that we have already taken, then it's fine, no worries. It's very important that we as developers, architects, everyone should know how to do some sketches. Everyone should know how to do some drawings. You don't have to be a professional artist, let's say, but you have to be able to express yourself just with a pencil, maybe in a paper, because this way it really happens to clear the communication between you and the other parts of the team. And when you have these visual artifacts, then later on it is really easy and really quickly you can produce decisions that are easy to save and to use later on. You don't have to be slave of some tools that because someone else is using, then you should use them too. Make the own rules in the team, because it is about your team being effective, not the other teams. We saw today some of the topics that you can't just copy other successful stories, because it's all about mindset, about the structure. So if you feel that in your team it's best that you are just using post-it notes, well, just go for it. I mean, make it nice and continue with this. If this is what it makes you effective and productive and lets you produce nice architecture, then you should continue doing it, because it's about the team being effective, and this is how the rest that you produce is going to be agile. So now I've prepared a very short case examples for one of my last projects. I have simplified it a lot just to demonstrate to how we have been applying agile in our process and how the software architecture itself has been made, has been kept up to date according to the changes that we have seen. So this project was about one big ferry company that they want us to make them online system where they sell tickets. Nice. They have their inventory system that we should use. It's very simple. And they had one a bit weird in the beginning requirement that they wanted us to make the system in that way so that they could rewrite the backend part or the business part in some other language afterwards. We were using C#, but they said, okay, make it whatever you want, but make it as easy as possible for us to change this C# with something else afterwards. And then we said, yes, we'll think about it. And our first iteration of the architecture was like this. It's very simple. We start with a really, really simple. We say, all right, we want to do a bit modern architecture, so we'll use a rich client, basically in the browser, and then we'll introduce some service layer or API layer, which will contain all the rules afterwards. And if they want to change these rules, they could rewrite it in whatever language, as long as they keep the service interface the same, everything is fine. So this is our decision. Maybe there are some other decisions. This is not that important now. And then we decide, okay, we have some data store where we are going to save some temporary data, and this is their external inventory service that we've been working with. So this is our initial iteration of the software architecture. We did it, we started implementing it. And then in this in the sprint, we started like seeing the problems with this. First of all, this external inventory service, it had some problems. It required some authentication on some of the methods, not on all of them. And this had to be implemented custom. So it wasn't really a standard. It wasn't like OAuth or any other standard that is using. It was very, very custom that we had to implement our, to make our client basically working with. Then we also realized that this data which we are getting from their web service, it's not complete. They wanted us to do some changes in our system because their system was that big that it was extremely expensive and slow process if they had to do the changes in their backend system. So they want us, okay, please, can you modify maybe here instead of this string, you write something else. So this kind of changes. They want us to do some manipulations on this data. So all right, we do it. And then we get on the second iteration where what we say, all right, instead of directly communicating with your service, then we introduce some proxy here, which is going to do this for us. So this proxy will be responsible for manipulating the data that we get from your service, and our API layer is going to work perfectly with it, as it is, everything is happening there. By doing this, we say we isolate totally your service, and we can work further with it. But now we get another problem. This, again, this inventory service apparently is performing very slow on some methods. The customer, the clients, basically, they had to wait, users on the website, they had to wait between 5 and 10 minutes to see just a list of all the available tickets. I said, okay, this is not going to work anyway. No one is going to wait such a long time to see just a list of available tickets. Imagine yourself for buy a flight ticket, for example, that when you click search and then you drink a coffee, maybe make a lunch, and then you come back and you see just the list. So this was, there was a big problem here, apparently. Furthermore, the inventory system was very weak because if we stressed it too much, how you define too much, well, we didn't know. The problem was that we didn't get any documentation about this service. The client was that enthusiastic about the project and said, we have this, our service, you should use it, it can help with everything. And what we did, we get just a SOAP service and everything else was basically based on our own test and our own working examples with their service. So we realized that some of the methods, when you book a ticket, for example, or when you do some other query methods, the system was basically going down, and then the server had to be restarted, and it all started again. So we need to figure out something else here. And then we say, okay, our next iteration will be to add some caching here. Why not? When we add caching, we'll save the data from your web service, and next time the user requires, makes a request, we'll serve it from the cache, so it will be very quick. Users don't have to wait anymore. The service won't be stressed anymore. Everything is, everyone is happy. All right, but not really, because there was another problem afterwards. And apparently, customers, they started seeing some tickets that were sold out. They started seeing them as a, that they were available. And this was apparently a problem, because you don't like it. When you want to see a ticket, you want to be sure that it is available. And okay, we realized that we were caching a bit too much information, but we didn't know when a ticket was available. It's only their system that knows when this ticket is available. The only thing that we do is that we list all these tickets and then just make the booking with their system. So again, what we did in this situation is that we say, all right, we have this API layer. So what we're going to do is we're going to give you a web service, and as you are the one that knows when a ticket is sold out, please call us at this time and we are going to clear the cache. Again, it's a very simple solution, I think, that we took, and apparently it did work for some time. This is just a part of the project that I want just to demonstrate how we've been doing this. This whole process has been applied for already like 2 months in the almost most of the part of this project that we have had. And in this project, all the things, all the problems that we have encountered, we have updated them right away. And we have also updated all these materials that we have, the architecture and the design, because some of these changes required also changes in the design, for example, on the user interaction. And as we wanted to keep this agile, we updated everything based on these changes. it is really rarely happens that when some problem occurs or your customer comes with a new wish about something that you could implement, it's really rarely happens that this change affects only one place in the system. Typically, it's two, three, maybe the code, maybe also the design, maybe also the whole architecture. So everything should be kept up to date according to this Agile. So here is a conclusion I want to say, that software architecture, as long as the other parts of the Agile processes, they are also affected by changes. And we have to think how these changes is kept in our system. How do we keep it up to date? If we don't do this, then we risk to omit some knowledge at a later point in the project. We should start as easy as possible with a few things as possible in our architecture. Don't put enough complexity, don't put abstractions that are not going to be used later. If we keep the things simple, then this allows us to be really flexible when we have to do changes on later point. When we do the proper documentation, then we're safe because our team, everything that our team produces is kept in one in another place, in one in another form that we think it's best for us, be it whiteboards, drawings, be it some pictures, be it some notes, whatever we think it's really good for us to do. And when we have these processes in the team, then we are sure that our architecture is safe in the hands. So, thank you. You have a question?
Yeah.
Yes?
My question is, how do you handle the financial contribution from the client's side if the scope obviously goes way beyond the original plan?
You mean in the scope of the software architecture, mainly? Well, this is this problem affects the whole project. It's not, I wouldn't say that it will affect only software architecture, because I think that if you don't spend enough time on doing a good architecture, then you risk that your project will go above the budget, because it requires more time later and more people involved to fix the issues. But if you invest more time in the beginning, especially to produce a software architecture that encompasses all these changes, all these requirements of your customer, then I think you're safe. If the project goes after budget, then it's a total planning that is a problem, and then you have to decide with your customer. Maybe you want to omit some feature from the system. Maybe you say, okay, the system is not going to be to perform that quickly because we don't have time to make it. Maybe you extend the deadline. Maybe you release version one, which is very with a lot of bugs. So this is all the things that has to be negotiated with the client.
Basically, you have not set any timelines nor budgets in those 2 months while you have been working on this architecture. You said that you have spent already 2 months.
Yes.
There is no contract, no...
No. There is a contract, there is a budget. We don't split the budget on an activity. We don't say you get this much for the architecture, we get this much for the development, this much for the design. We have the whole budget, and then we are splitting it in a way that we see that it's reasonable. If the design needs more budget, well, then we give it there. If the architecture, we are talking about some complex system, then it makes sense that you put more money into the architecture in the beginning especially. Because in this way, you can prototype afterwards the architecture and see if it is reasonable.
So basically, you have a budget, but you don't have a clear deliverable. The deliverable will be defined during the process. That's what the client is okay with.
Yes.